Thank you. Mr. President, we are living in historic times. The 115th Congress will be the first time in a decade that Republicans have held both chambers of Congress and the White House. Before the George W. Bush administration in the early parts of this century, you'd have to go back to the Eisenhower administration, I believe it was 1945, to find a comparable time of Republican control. Interestingly, for the history buffs in the who may be listening, there's actually been 14 times since 1945 when you've had single-party majorities in both houses and the White House. 11 of those times have been our Democratic colleagues, and 3 times have been Republicans. So I come back to where I started in saying these are truly historic times. This morning, our Republican conference met to elect our leadership team to serve in the next Congress during this extraordinary time. After gaining the majority 2 years ago, it's been a pleasure to look back and see what we have been able to accomplish, even with the president from the opposing party in the White House. Yesterday, I mentioned the rewrite of No Child Left Behind, which sent more authority back to the states and parents and teachers to make education decisions for children in kindergarten through 12th grade. And I also mentioned passing a long-term highway bill for 5 years, something we hadn't been able to do for a long, long time. But those are just 2 concrete examples of how, working together, we can tackle big, intractable problems. And frankly, nothing happens around here in the United States Senate unless it is bipartisan. But we also passed some other important legislation, something negotiated by Majority Leader in the House at the time, Nancy Pelosi, or Leader Pelosi, and Speaker John Boehner, which was reform of our Social Security laws in terms of how doctors under Medicare are paid, an important item, because if doctors are not paid a prevailing fee or competitive fee for their services, they're simply not going to see Medicare patients, and the seniors are not going to have access to the care that they deserve. We also passed a bill sanctioning North Korea for its nuclear program and its human rights abuses. And we also passed legislation to better support our troops who fight and put themselves in harm's way to keep us safe every day. So I'm grateful to our Republican colleagues for voting to continue the direction of progress for the American people by reelecting their current leadership, including the senior senator from Kentucky, Senator McConnell. I've had the honor, as all of us have, to serve alongside Senator McConnell for several years now, although I've served for the last 4 years as the whip, or the right hand of the majority leader when it comes to trying to corral votes and try to promote our legislative agenda. And I've found the majority leader to be a wise and steady hand in a town marked by the absence of those virtues among many. So I'm proud to serve with him in the next Congress, as I am with all of our colleagues, and in his case, as the majority leader, as his assistant. We also had a chance, having come back together after the election, to talk about the future and to talk about our agenda going forward. Yesterday, I pointed out several legislative priorities at the top of the list, policy items that we have to get right on behalf of the American people, like confirming a Supreme Court justice who will interpret the laws as we write them and as the Constitution is written, rather than seeing themselves as somehow another policy-making branch of government. We've also run and promised that we would repeal and replace Obamacare, which was a failed experiment. Failed because the president, when he promoted it, said that if you like what you have, you can keep it. Said if you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor, and an average family of 4 will see their premiums go down $2,500, none of which has proven to be true. So it's very important we keep that promise of repealing Obamacare and then replacing it on a step-by-step basis over a transition period with more affordable health care that will preserve the choices in health care to Americans and their families, and not Washington, D.C. And then there's the matter of regulation. If there's one thing that after our Democratic friends lost their 60-vote majority in the United States Senate and the House Republicans flipped the House to have divided government, if there's one thing that's characterized the Obama administration, it's been executive actions and overregulation. In August, it was reported that the president had, in his administration, had issued 600 major regulations with a price tag of more than $740 billion. And if there's one thing I hear from my constituents back in Texas, small business owners and the like, it's they are feeling the strangling effect of overregulation, along with the costs of compliance and the uncertainty that goes along with it. So it's no surprise, really, to see that our economy is essentially flatlined and not been growing, because none of this is good for the small business owners that we're relying upon to create jobs and opportunities, and it's not good for American families who are looking for those jobs in order to provide for their families and simply put food on the table. So we're eager to roll back those expensive and unnecessary, in many instances, and certainly in every instance, burdensome regulations so the economy can have some breathing room and begin to grow again. Many of us are interested in addressing tax reform as well. There's bipartisan consensus that our tax code is simply too complex and counterproductive. In fact, it is literally a self-inflicted wound when it comes to forcing $2 trillion plus of dollars overseas that American-based companies would like to bring back, but the reason they don't do it is because they would be subject to double taxation, first in the country where they have been, where the money's been earned, and secondly, when they would bring it back to the United States. Well, rather than do that, many of them have left that money overseas, which means rather than investing in American jobs and American infrastructure, they are literally investing in jobs overseas and in building infrastructure to support their facilities in other countries, which makes no sense whatsoever. So tax reform is high on our agenda. And I believe that at a time when everybody understands that our tax code has simply gotten too complex, too expensive, and too counterproductive, I'm optimistic that we'll be able to make some real progress. Coming from a border state, I can tell you that I'm delighted to hear President-elect Trump talk about the importance of border security. In a post-9/11 world, it is simply critical that we know who is coming into our country and make sure that they do so only by legal means. So securing our border is something we need to deal with, and thank goodness there's no shortage of good ideas. Chairman Michael McCaul and the House Homeland Security Committee has got a bipartisan bill that I think would make great progress along those lines, but obviously we're going to have an important discussion among all members of Congress and the administration about how best to accomplish the goal. But we also need to remember that our ports of entry, which are where legitimate trade and travel occur, that we do nothing to impede that, because legitimate trade and travel are very important to our economy. The U.S. economy enjoys about 6 million jobs just as a result of trade between the United States and Mexico alone. So I look forward to working with the administration and with our colleagues to make sure we secure our border against illegal immigration, including the human trafficking, drug traffic, and potential violence that goes along with that, while making sure that our legitimate trade and travel and our ports of entry are supported so that we can benefit from those as well. And of course, as we discussed and debated earlier this Congress, having updated and efficient infrastructure is vital to the health and well-being of our economy. And I mentioned the transportation bill that we passed, a long-term transportation bill that will provide for some of that, but certainly not all that is necessary. We need to take a look at the proposals that the president-elect is going to send our way, but there's no shortage of good ideas being discussed both in the House and the Senate as well. I look forward to learning more about those, but one thing that hasn't been talked about very much, Mr. President, is how we're going to pay for it. And that's going to be an important item to discuss as well, because frankly, we can't keep spending our kids' and grandkids' inheritance, or at least forcing upon the younger generations the obligation to pay for bills that we incur today. And one of the things I hope that will occur as a result of this historic election is that we will have the courage and the willingness to sit down and come up with structural solutions to our financial situation, which is $19 trillion plus in debt. Because of the Federal Reserve keeping interest rates very low, we're not having to pay huge amounts of money in order to service that debt or pay interest to the people who own that debt. But that's going to change if the Federal Reserve begins to raise interest rates, and we're going to find ourselves paying more and more money to service that debt to the bondholders, and less of that money available for our priorities here in the, domestically, whether they be national security or other investments and things like research, medical research and the like. So finding out how we can crack that nut and come together on a bipartisan basis, working with the White House to deal with our long-term fiscal problems and continue to meet the needs of our nation, are going to be challenging but exhilarating to do. Mr. President, many are talking about the next steps and what should and shouldn't happen in light of the new political reality. But what's clear to me today is that Republicans are united by a strong desire to listen to the concerns of the American people and to deliver results, results that make their lives easier and our collective futures stronger. But I want to say, as committed as the majority party is to that, we can't do this alone without the cooperation and the consensus building that comes along as part of the legislative process. Unfortunately, we've seen the last years characterized by obstruction and filibusters and blocking things that are essentially already receive bipartisan support, and I'm talking particularly about the appropriations process. One of the terrible things that's happened this last year in the United States Congress is the appropriations committees have gotten back to work on a bipartisan basis. You'd see bills coming out at a fiscally responsible level, agreed upon spending caps, with Democrats and Republicans supporting them, only to see them dead on arrival on the floor of the United States Senate. That's the kind of mindless obstructionism that I hope we can avoid going forward. And just from the conversations I've had as a result of this election, many of our Democratic colleagues appear to be willing to work with us, and certainly with the new leadership on the Democratic side of the aisle, I'm more optimistic than I've been in a long time that we can come together while maintaining our strongly held convictions and principles. I'm not talking about compromising those, but rather working together when we can and trying to develop more ideas to better serve the American people. Mr. President, I would yield the floor, and I'd note the absence of